should all get it by tonight, and it will most likely be tonight, as opposed to earlier in the day. We will continue talking about persistent homology today, and then we will have a brief introduction to the JavaPlex software. I'm on a new thing now. I'm using the Bamboo tablet, Wacom mouse, so it's going to be a little getting used to, but I think my handwriting might be better. So, just a reminder, if you do take a look at the website, the schedule page, so this one right here, you do see that there are a number of links to reading material, plus extra reading material, and I've just noticed that I need to update this additional reading, so I will add a few more things here. And then on the side here, you can see that we have the video, PowerPoint, and PDF slides are posted right underneath the date for each stuff. You can also go straightly to the YouTube page for the videos, but the PowerPoint and the PDFs, you'll find linked here. I'll try to post the PDFs and PowerPoints before the lecture, but I will often post newer versions after the lecture where I mostly just cut off things that, you know, some, I'll frequently prepare way more lectures than, way more slides than I know we'll cover, but I will try to have at least enough for today. So, again, it will be persistent homology continuation, and then we'll go into the JavaPlex. Any questions before I begin? So we're going to continue talking about the paper Computing Persistent Homology. Last time, we took a look at the boundary one map going from the one-dimensional objects. I forgot to select the pen. Well, from the one-dimensional objects to the... So we can see from our map that if we take a look at boundary one, and we go from these one-dimensional edges to our zero-dimensional vertices, we can see that the image of boundary one is going to be T times D plus C, 1C plus TB, and T times A plus B, and so we got the image, the column space of M1, the map corresponding to boundary one. We can also calculate the kernel, that's just what goes to zero, and we can see that since these columns are linearly independent, any linear combination of these first three columns won't go to zero, but any linear combination of these last two columns will go to zero, so we can see that our null space is just generated by these last two columns, and so we can see what our null space is. Thus, we got our H-naught last time. Our null space for our boundary zero map was everything went to zero. So we got, sorry, everything went to zero, and so our generators were just all of the vertices. I wasn't able to borrow the tablet over the weekend, the mouse I'm using, so I'm practicing it really for the first time. The first 5 minutes of practice weren't well, but we'll see how it goes now. So we do have that we're modding out by all, sorry, these are our generators, everything went to zero, and then we mod out by our column space, and so we do have that being our column space, so we got our H0 last time. We now want to go ahead and get H1. For H1, we're going to need just our Z1, so we're going to take a look at our kernel right here, and then mod out by our B1, the image of boundary 2. So we have that our H1, we now know what our null space is. Our null space was just our kernel of boundary 1, so we have that, but we now need to know the image of boundary 2, the column space of M2, to mod out by that. The easiest way, though, to mod out is if, you know, this generator right here of the null space is a little bit complicated, as is this one, so it would be a lot easier to mod out if our column space has that in our basis. So we are going to use these two elements as our basis, so we'll call that Z1 and Z2, and then we're going to go ahead and take a look at B1, taking a look at the column space of M2, using the same basis as we had for our M1. So if we take a look at what our basis was, it was at C, D, B, C, A, B, etc., Z1, Z2. So we're going to want to have exactly the same basis for M2 as well. So this is our M2 map. We can see that in terms of our M2, if I take the boundary of ABC, the boundary of ABC is AB, BC, and AC. And we just have to denote the time at which they enter in. So ABC entered in at time 4, so that entered in at time 4. BC and AB, they both entered in at time, so BC and AB, they both entered in at time 1. 4 minus 1 is 3, and so thus we have T cubed to keep track of, that it enters in 3 units later, that ABC enters in 3 units later after BC and AB. Versus if I take a look at AC, so taking a look at AC, it entered in at time 3, so ABC entered in 1 unit later, and so we just have T to the 1 right here. And so we get our M2 map, where just like last time, our powers just say how many units later are ACD simplex entered after CD. We now want to do row operations on this, but we want to do similar row operations as we did column operations on M1, so we get the same basis. So I'm doing a bunch of a bunch of row operations right here, where my only concern is to get the same basis. So I don't really care how you do the row operations, as long as you get the same basis as we had for our M1. So the same basis as for our edges, our 1 simplices, so that top row right there for M1. So we're just trying to get the same basis, so we just do a bunch of row operations. How we do them doesn't really matter, but eventually we do row operations, and now we have a nice form here. You'll notice that there was a slide that's called this the long method. This is the long method. Didn't actually have to do all those row operations, because you will notice that if this right here is my M1 and this right here is my M2, or MK and MK plus 1, when I do column operations, I get it into column echelon form. So this is column, instead of row echelon form, we have column echelon form. Where I go down here, I've got my first non-zero leading entry and zeros to the right of it. We go down here, our first non-zero entry, so this is not zero, so we have some number here, that's not zero. And then we use that to get zeros over here, non-zero, zeros over here, and so we know that everything white here is zero. Well, we know when we multiply M1 by M2, when you do boundary twice, what do you get? You get zero. So thus, if I multiply this row by this column right here, well, doing this row by this column, I have a non-zero thing plus a bunch of zeros times something plus who cares. Well, I have non-zero. This had better be zero right here to get non-zero times zero plus a bunch of zeros from here to get me a zero. Similarly, if I use the second column, this non-zero thing right here is going to get me a zero right there. And so when I multiply out, I'm going to be getting that this thing right here is zero, corresponding to my pivot columns right here. And so I know for each of these pivot columns, I'm going to be getting a zero row for each of these things here. And so we know right away that we've got a zero. So we take a look at the particular example where we multiplied our M1 So we multiplied our M1 times our M2 in order to do boundary 2 composed with boundary 1. So when we do our matrix multiplication, I do boundary 2 first, and then I do my boundary 1. Well, you can see that when I multiply these things, I'm going to have these first three rows will all have to be 0 in order to get the 0 math right here. We can even say more than that. Let's compare our M1 and our M2. So let's compare our M1 and our M2 right here. How did I get these zeros right here? Well, when I did my column operations, I used my pivot columns right here to get my zeros. So now when I'm doing my row operations, yeah, I'll be using these things right here to actually get my zeros here, because remember there was a big difference between when you do your row operations and your column operations. When I do my change of basis on my M1 and I do column operations, when I do my column operations, I wanted to make sure that I did a change of basis. So if I did AD plus CD plus T times BC plus T times AB, if I did that column operation into this column, well then that became my new basis for this column. But for my row operation, I wanted my boundary of ABC to still make sense. My boundary of ABC should still be AC plus T squared BC plus T squared AB. It still needs to be that element here times T. So my boundary of ABC, remember we said that the boundary of ABC was AB, but it entered in 3 units later. And so we need to have T times my T squared times my ABC. So now when I do my change of basis, whenever I do say AC plus T squared AB, in order to get a zero here, well, I was actually changing my basis element in this row here instead. So how we did our row operations was a little bit different. So at some point, we will also show how to do this for oriented simplices, and we will extremely quickly go over it, but I'll have lots of slides that we'll cover in 2 minutes. But just to see the difference when we've got the row operation. So we'll go over this once more with oriented simplices. But that means that since I only used these columns here to affect these bases, I also only use these rows here to affect this basis. So in other words, the shortest way of doing this operation, the short method, is to go from my original M2 to do a change of basis, since I knew that my first three rows would correspond to pivot columns in M1, they automatically became zeros here. So they automatically became zeros here. And my last two rows, well, they became my basis here, and I still had the same elements here. And so we can very quickly do our row operations. We just do our change of bases, put the zeros in, and we've got it. So we now have our M2. And since we now have our M2, we can now go ahead and figure out our column space of M2. And remember, when we're figuring out our column space of M2, that we called this one was our Z1, and this one here is our Z2. And so what is the image of boundary 2? Well, the image of boundary 2 is going to be T times Z2. So we've got T times Z2. And then my image of ACD will be T cubed times my Z1 plus T squared times my Z2. So we have In the image of boundary 2, we've got t cubed times rz1 plus t squared times rz2. And then any linear combination of these two things will therefore be in our image. So that's our image. What's our kernel? Well, if I take a look at this, this is already in a pseudo-echelon form, well, in column echelon form. I should have switched these two columns. But in either case, they're both pivot columns. What do I have in terms of my zero columns? I don't have any null space, and so they're both pivot columns, so my kernel of boundary 2 is 0. Any questions up through there? So, in better handwriting, we've got our image of boundary 2 and our kernel of boundary 2. So we can now use our image of boundary 2 to go ahead and mod out by that. And it becomes much easier to now see what our null space is mod our column space, because we have, in terms of z1 and z2, both our null space and our column space. It's nice if we have the pictures, you know, we can take a look back at the pictures to see that it makes sense, but it's nice that we can do this all within notation. On Friday, we will take a look at another way of simplifying this, so we will be able to simplify this using algebraic shorthand, which we will cover on Friday. In the meantime, let's also calculate H2. Well, H2 was easy because our null space was 0. Since our null space is 0, we have automatically 0. We also didn't have any three-dimensional complexes, so our image of boundary 3 would have also been 0 since C3 is 0. And we can see that from here, that we don't have any interesting H2. There are no space, there are no spheres in here, or no two-dimensional poles. So now let's go ahead and see if we can calculate our persistent homology for H1. For H2, it's boring because everything is 0, but for H1, we did have some interesting Z1s, we did have some interesting B1s, and remember, for our persistent homology, we take a look at all the cycles that start off at time I, and then we mod out by the boundaries that occur p units later, assuming they make sense. So let's take a look at H1 of starting off with time 2. Well, first off, why did I start off with time 2 right here? I'm looking at H1. At time 2, that's when we start getting, So we're starting off at time 2, so we are going to be starting off here at our time 2. We could also have started off at time 1, but it seems I didn't have those slides. I thought I had the time 1 slide as well. Maybe they will occur later. But we'll start off at time 2, in which case this is our complex right here. So at time 2, oh, we are starting off with the correct thing. We just have to remember what Z1 means. And for a second, I forgot what cycles meant. So, who can tell me why I should start off at time 2 if I want to look at a cycle? If I want to look at a cycle, the first time we have a cycle is at time 2. We don't have any cycles. So, before time 2, we don't have any cycles, so we really don't care about cycles before time 2. So, if I take a look at H1 of 1 comma p, that'll be 0 because I don't have any cycles. So we don't have any nice closed cycles. Before that, same thing at time 0, we don't have any cycles. And so the first interesting case is at time 2. And we do start creating a cycle. So how did I know that? Well, I looked at my generators. My generators started off at degree 2. And then my other one was at degree 3. So before degree 2, we don't have anything interesting. But at degrees 2, and 3, we start having some cycles. Remember, when we take a look at this, my AD and my CD both came in at degree 2. My BC came in at time 1, as well as my AB did. But we then multiplied it by 2 so that we had a nice homogeneous polynomial. So the other thing we wanted to do, remember, was to have a nice homogeneous polynomial. That makes it a lot easier to calculate these things, because then we know exactly at what time our generator comes in. It's a degree 2 polynomial, so it is degree 2. I'm probably shouldn't use the word polynomial. It's degree 2 cycle, because all of these things are degree 2. As a polynomial, it might be degree 1, but as a cycle, it's degree 2. It enters in at time 2, as we can see in the picture. So at time 2, we get a z mod 2z component, which I could have written this as z2, but because we have an awful lot of subscripts with some z's attached to it, I'm going to use the longer format for z mod 2 to do z mod 2z. Means exactly the same thing. Well, the question is, how long does this cycle last? To determine how long this cycle lasts, then I start looking at the relators. So now I'll start taking a look at the relators. Well, the degree of t times z2, well, if z2 is of degree 3, then if I multiply it by t, remember that moves it up 1 degree, and so 3 plus 1 gives me a degree 4. If I take a look at this nice homogeneous homogeneous boundary right here, well, z1 was degree 2, but when I add 3 to that, that becomes degree 5. z2 was of degree 3, but when I add 2 to that, that also becomes degree 5. And so this boundary has degree 5. So if I now take a look at my cycle was z1, my cycle was z1. We kill off z2 at time 4, but we don't kill off z1. Until we're at time 5. And so this z1 actually persists. It doesn't get killed off until we add on a cd. And so we now have that this thing actually exists. Well, this cycle existed 0 units later, so at time 2 it existed. It existed 1 unit later at time 3. It still exists at time 4, 2 units later after time 2, so it still exists at time 4. Yeah, it looks a little bit different. At this time, this cycle right here is homologous to this cycle, so I can push the square cycle, this squarish cycle, across this boundary right here, across this 2 simplex, and see that they are, via homology the same at time 4. And so this z1 cycle persists for p equals to 0, 1, and 2. However, at 3 units later, then we cancel it out. And so we can calculate h1 of 2 comma p. It's z mod 2 for p equals to 0, 1, and 2. And it is 0 for p equal to 3. So for p equal to 3, it's going to be 0. So we also have that it's 0 for a whole bunch of other things. So if I take a look at this thing here, it's also going to be 0 for everything, as we said, for I less than 2, we don't have any one-dimensional cycles. There are no one-dimensional cycles, and so we do have 0 for I less than 2. So, it appears, so when I was practicing the Wacom, I thought I did a control Z, my slides got out of order, so now we can see what I was saying before. Accidentally moved my slides out of order, but we're back to, for our 2 case, We do have in the readable handwriting that it's Z-Ma 2 for 0, 1, and 2, but it is for P equals to 3. We do have that it is 0 for P equals to 3. Sorry for getting my slides out of order when practicing with this workbook. Okay, so we have the case now for I equals to 0, 1, and 2. We can now take a look at the other cases. I will leave those as homework, but we do the same sort of thing to go ahead and calculate those. So those will be homework and or quizzes. If you do want access to the quizzes, they are on ICON, so email me and I can add you to the ICON list. Email me by Wednesday and I'll get everyone added to the ICON. I do have an email from people from Canada at the moment. You will get added this week, and anybody else who emails me by Wednesday will get added and will have access to the ICON quizzes. So one of these things might be an ICON problem. Okay, what we really like, however, you know, sometimes we're interested in those I, P things, but what we really care about is the barcode. The barcode is a nice pictorial representation. We will get an algebraic representation for this barcode on Friday as well. But for now, we like the pictorial description. We did the H0, so we got these last time. Let's now take a look at this one here as well. I can see that Z1 was degree 2, so it entered in at time 2. Z2 was degree 3, so it entered in at time 3. And so that's where these things came from. And then we just need to remember that this one here was degree 4, this one was degree 5. Let me actually write down all these degrees here. They won't usually be consecutive, but it helps if you've got a bad memory. Just for this example, not normally consecutive. This one has a Z1 in it, so that's why I know this one goes all the way up to Z5. This one, however, has a Z2 in it. And so I can see that one unit later, so this T right here tells me that one unit later, we're going to cancel out this thing here at time 4. So I can see that Z2 gets canceled out either by looking at that this is a degree 4, or by looking at T times Z2 means it gets canceled out one unit later. Here, I can look at it by seeing that it's a degree 5, that's the simplest. But I also know that T cubed times Z1, it gets canceled out 3 units later. And I know that T cubed times Z1 had better be degree 5 because this is a degree 5 object right here, a degree 5 boundary. And so we do have our nice barcodes. And so barcodes give us nice visual descriptions of these things. There is also an algebraic shorthand to write the barcode, which we'll again describe on So now what we want to take a look at is the actual JavaPlex software. So you'll note that if you go to the Comp Top site, so there's a whole bunch of people who do this applied algebraic topology, and they've created a number of different software programs, a number of different papers, so it got cut off. But if you don't, if you can't get access to a paper because you don't have your university doesn't subscribe to the journal, well, go to the CompTop site. If any of the Stanford people are an author of the article, you can download it from this website right here. So just click on their preprints. So it's a nice website. I've clicked on the software site, and we will now take a look at the software. You go to the web page, it tells you where you can download it. You can also download it via the links on my schedule website as well, but if you go to the CompTop site, that's the direct link too. The easiest way to go ahead and learn it is to take, just to download the MATLAB examples. It includes the JavaPlex software. So if you download the MATLAB examples, it's really well documented, as well as the tutorial. So the tutorial is the documentation. If you download that tutorial and the MATLAB examples, you will know exactly how to run it. You do not need me. You could, you know, shut off this lecture right now and just go straight to the JavaPlex examples. However, I will give you So this is the stuff here where you can see on this side, we can download these MATLAB examples right here. Just some useful commands that are basically Linux-based. There was a zip file, so if you're on a PC, just download the zip file. If, however, you are on a Linux or a Mac, then you would, you know, whatever foo is the shorthand for file name, so it would be MATLAB examples 4.something-or-other.tar, and you can extract it using this Linux command, which also works well on a Mac. If you use a Linux interface, or a Mac interface, just clicking on the tar file will probably unzip it automatically. But if you're old like me, you like using the command terminal, and so these will work in the command. When you're doing MATLAB, well then, you want to use commands. That is basically command line driven. They haven't gotten to a nice GUI interface yet for every single thing, and plus all the commands via GUI interface, that would just get complicated. It's so much simpler to use a terminal line command. So at any rate, these commands here will actually work for both MATLAB, Mac, Linux. It'll work for all of them. You can change into your directory, so if you save it into a different directory, you can move around your different directories, and if you forget where you are, you can always go back to your main directory by just doing cd, or better yet, just do pwd for print working directory to find out what directory you are in. I also like these two commands. Ls will just list your directory content. I frequently will do, there should be a space right here, so note there is a space right there. I like the minus lrt. The minus l gives me the long format. The RT gives me in reverse time. I frequently do that to check my permissions when I post things on my website to make sure the permissions are set so you can actually access these things. Okay, so this is the JavaPlex tutorial, that PDF that I recommend getting, which you can get either off their website or downloaded via the schedule website. I basically just cut and paste their comments. If we have time, we'll go ahead and open a MATLAB and do some of these things, but I just cut and paste from their PDF because it's just quicker and I don't have to worry about MATLAB crashing on me. You do have to have Java 1.5 or higher. You can see that my MATLAB has this Java version right now. I may upgrade to get a higher Java version, but it has that. The next thing, actually, I didn't fully, this is actually copied and pasted from my, when I ran it, just so that it wouldn't look identical to the tutorial. I put the MATLAB examples. When I untarted, in this directory, my applied topology directory. And when I untarted, it created this directory and it put all the JavaPlex, the .m files over here. And so I cd'd into this directory right there. And I could then go ahead and just load this thing. Every time you run it, this is basically your library of things. So you need to run each and every time you want to run JavaPlex. So you aren't just installing JavaPlex. You're basically loading the library. So that means that you can't just install it once and have it working each time. You have to install it each time because you're really just loading the library each time. So each time you want to run it, put this command there. You don't have to confirm it, but if you use this command, which is within that tutorial, it will confirm that it is running properly. So if you ever have problems, you might want to do this just to make sure everything's running properly. If you don't have problems, you probably don't even need to run that. So now let's go ahead and take a look at the tutorial questions. So the tutorial problems. This was one tutorial problem where we will create an empty explicit simplex. So we just create a simplicial complex that is empty via this thing right here. So this command right here will create a simplicial complex. It's just it will be empty. It will have absolutely nothing in it. Today we're going to go over the long-winded commands for entering a simplicial complex by hand. On Wednesday, we will actually upload real data. So we won't, today we are going to stick to the tutorial web page for the most part, but on Wednesday we will actually look at real data. So in here you can see how to add a vertex, so to this stream, so to this stream right here. So we will go ahead and add a vertex, and you can see we're adding vertex 0, 1, and 2, so 0, 1, and 2. We then add element. This element can be used to add any higher dimensional simplex. So dimensions 1 and higher, you just use the closed bracket. So if we use this closed bracket right here, I can add the edge 0, 1. I can then also add the edge 0, 2. I can add the edge 1, 2. And then it is nice to finalize your stream if you're done. If you're not done, I could have added the face 0, 1, 2, and that would have allowed me to go ahead and fill in this space. So we use this command to add any higher dimension after adding the vertices. So we now have our simplicial complex. Let's go ahead and create a filtered simplicial complex. So to create the filtered simplicial complex, I need to say when, at what time things were ended. So this is the name of the vertex, so that's my vertex name. These right here, the second element, those are all the times. So these are all the times. So that's the times when it's been created. Same thing here, all of these second coordinates, all of these second coordinates, they are all telling you the time when the simplex entered in. So we can see that we have vertices 1, 2, 3, 4, oh, not 5. Let me, we'll ignore this one at the moment. That entered in at time 1. And then we had 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 1. Those all entered in at time 0. Then at time 1, we entered this thing right here. And then at time 3, two, at time 2, we entered in, sorry, 3, 5. So that was 3, 5. And then at time 4, we could enter in 4, 5. And then at time 7, we went ahead and filled in the simplex. And then finalize the stream. We could have, before we finalize the stream, I could have gone ahead and added this element right here, 145 at time 0. But there's a little bit of a problem with adding that thing at time 0, since I've chosen a darker color, blue, is that if you remember, my 4 and, you know, my 5 didn't even exist at time 0. But computer programs let you do things that are incorrect. So you can create a simplicial complex that is not filtered. I can accidentally add this thing in here, even though this thing did not exist at that time. So I can go ahead and add this one in at time 0, but that would be a bad thing because this vertex didn't exist at time 0, neither did this one here. That edge didn't exist at time 0, and so we don't want to do that. And so if you use the stream validate, notice if I do stream validate before I add this incorrect element, I'll get answer is 1. That means it was an actual filtered. So this means you had an actual filtered simplicial complex. But if you get an error message like this, this is an error message. It says, yeah, maybe I eventually at time 5 I might have a simplicial complex, but at time 0 I don't, because I can't have this thing without having all its faces. We can't have without having all its faces. We need all the faces to be able to create this. So that is something that you definitely might want to do from time to time. It doesn't hurt to throw it in just to make sure you didn't enter in something incorrectly. Okay. There's another couple of commands that are interesting. So in the example in the tutorial, they did S9. I'm just going to do a simple S2. So my dimension will be 2. This is just actually a variable. So we go ahead and create our empty simplex. So this first line is we're just creating an empty simplex. It's this next line that I accidentally crossed out, so I will change my pen color. In this line right here, what you're doing here is adding a, so just this entire command right here means I'm adding a three-dimensional simplex. So what we just did here is we're adding the three-dimensional simplex. So we've added this three-dimensional simplex, but without its boundary. So all I've gone ahead and added is my V1, V2, V3, V4, since I started counting at V1. It probably started counting at V0, so I probably should have gone V0 to V3, but we've created just this one object right here. If I were to run validate, it would complain because that is not a valid simplicial complex. I need to throw in V1, I need to throw in V2, I need to throw in the edge V1, V2, I need to throw in the face. Well, a quick way now to throwing in that face is to do the ensure all faces. So, in other words, if you want to do, to make sure all your faces are there, you can do this ensure all faces command. And now I've gone ahead and thrown in all the vertices are now in, all the edges are now in, all the faces have now been thrown in. And so you actually have everything. And if I now want to create the two sphere, well, then I actually don't want this simplex. I don't want this three-dimensional simplex right here, the solid tetrahedron. I want just the boundary of the tetrahedron. And so the other command that is useful is to remove an element. So if you want to remove this element if present, I'm now removing this element right here. So we remove that three-dimensional element. Dimension was 2, so 2 plus 1 is 3. I could have, by the way, just gone ahead and done 3 here. I didn't need to do dimension plus 1. We could have just done 3. But now you know how to create S1, S2, S3, S9, S13, etc. So any questions there? So that's the main way to create simplicial complexes by hand. But we will talk about how to create simplicial complexes from data points, from point cloud data on Wednesday. We now want to determine persistent homology. So now to determine our persistent homology, we can say just this now gets us to go ahead and calculate our persistent homology with the choice of 3 and 2. The 3 means I'm just going to determine the homology for I less than 3. So we can determine the zero-dimensional homology, the one-dimensional, and the two-dimensional, but we won't be determining the three-dimensional homology. And we're going to use Z2 coefficients. That's our 2. That means that if you wanted to calculate HI for all I up to 10, Well, if you want up to and including 10, you better put this one to be 11. And if you want, you can do Z7 coefficients. If you do P a prime, your coefficients are over a field, which can be quite helpful. I think you can do Z6, but that's not very as nice, and I have to make sure. I actually forgot to check whether it could do non-prime coefficients because things are not as easy in terms of the row operations. If I use Z6 coefficients, then if I have a coefficient 2 times t cubed, well, that 2 times t cubed, there's no inverse for t in z mod 6. Versus if I've got prime, then 2, 3, they all have inverses. And so we prefer prime numbers here. But you can, at minimum, choose any prime number. And I'll double check to see if you can also do composites. But generally speaking, you'd want to choose a prime number. And sometimes you do want to choose higher things. You know, for example, the Klein bottle and the Taurus have the same Z mod 2 homology, so maybe you might want to try something higher to see if you can get to determine the difference between the Taurus and the Klein bottle. So there are times when you do want to do other things besides Z mod 2. Okay. So you've got our persistence, and then we want to know what our intervals are. So we now get the intervals. You will notice also, I mentioned it the last time, so I'm doing all of this on MATLAB, but you don't have to use MATLAB. But if you do use MATLAB, remember that this suppresses the output. You don't always want to see the output. This is just calculating the persistence. You may not want to see all those calculations. Versus if I don't have it, then I get to see the output. Well, I want to actually see the intervals, so there's no semicolon. And then here I get to see this is the actual output. So that's the output. You'll note that we are calculating HI for I less than 3. So our dimension starts at 2. Well, if you have 0 homology, the fact that 2 does not show up tells me that my H2 is 0. So we know right now that my H2 is 0 because it doesn't show up. My dimension being 1 does tell me that I've got bars for my one-dimensional homology that start off at 0 and go all the way to infinity. And that also start off at 3 and end at 7. So for my one-dimensional homology, I have this particular barcode. If I then do my zero-dimensional homology, well, I also have from 0 to infinity, so I'll also have one for my zero-dimensional homology. But then I have for my zero-dimensional homology, I also have the 1, 2, and so we also have this, well, maybe I'll squeeze it down here, my 1, 2, so 1, 2, we also have that. This, by the way, was for that house that we had created. Remember when we put in these first 4 things at time 0, and then at time 1 we added this, at time 2 we added this one, time 3, and then at time 7. So you can see why we would be getting these particular barcodes for this house. Any questions about that? Okay. We can then also compute a representative cycle. So we can see in terms of our house what the cycles would be for both dimension 1 as well as for dimension 0. And then the last thing I wanted to say, which is not from the tutorial, is that we can enter a CSV file into MATLAB. So if you remember the breast cancer data, which you can download from my website as well, I'll link to it to the Wednesday site. We will actually probably work with a processed data, so I will also link to that as well, but it might become more processed between now and then. I have a volunteer processing it for me since my right arm is kind of not great at the moment. But you can read your file in this format right here. And if you go to this website, there are additional instructions if you wanted to get less of your matrix. So in particular, if you put in your file name, note you have to have the quotes around it. And then row column, you will probably want to start off at 1 and 1 because we've got text data and you don't want the names of the genes, you don't want the patient numbers. And so if you put 1, 1, that will eliminate that. And if you want to cut off your data at some point, go to the MathWorks website and it will tell you how to cut off the data. We will do that on Wednesday. Any questions before we end for today? So then, see you on Wednesday.